Well, good morning. And if you read the email last night, I had Cool and the Gang were playing through my head yesterday. You know, celebrate good times. Come on. Stuart Wilde wrote a little booklet I got many years ago. It was just a tiny little pamphlet, you know, maybe 3 inches by 2 inches at the most. And on the cover, it had a picture of him laying in a hammock with a big glass of iced tea in his hand. With a little bed straw, you know, and a big smile. And it said, life was never meant to be a struggle. Life was never meant to be a struggle. Now, we can make it that way. We as human beings can make it that way. We have a propensity to do so. Because embedded in our culture is this idea that if it's too easy, it's not valuable. Why is gold worth so much? It's rare. Beach sand is not worth so much because it's plentiful. No pain, no gain is a philosophy that runs through our culture. And if something is too easy, we will find a way to make it more difficult. So it seems more valuable. A game of basketball wouldn't be quite so interesting if the goals were only 3 feet off the ground. We have to raise them higher. We have to get people to shoot the basket from further away. It has to be an element of difficulty in order for our culture to appreciate something as valuable. So we tend to make things more than what they are. We tend to make things harder than what they are because our society tells us that makes them more important, more valuable. But it doesn't. We may believe that, but it doesn't. It only makes us believe that. So what we want to consider today is that God doesn't struggle. God doesn't struggle. God didn't create life to be a struggle. There's activity, yes, and there's a difference between being active and struggling. So sometimes people will hear this and say, well, what do you mean? I'm not supposed to do anything? No, of course not. Of course not. We're supposed to live. But it doesn't have to be a struggle. But when I look at the little booklet in the cover that says life was never meant to be a struggle, I think that that's only telling half the story, half the truth. Because not only is it not meant to be a struggle, but it's meant to be a celebration. It's meant to be joyful. It's meant to be happy. And if we stop and think about what this thing that we call God, what is this thing that we call God is, it's one. It's perfect unity. It's that perfect singularity that the physicists tell us existed before the Big Bang. The perfect singularity. Everything was one. And out of this one comes many. Out of one comes diversity. Out of one comes plurality. Out of one comes all of these beautiful expressions of itself. Because where did these things come from? Other than itself. And if everything in the universe, ourselves included, is an expression of the divine, and if the divine nature is one of peace, is one of perfection, is one of abundance, is one of love, perfect love, then that must be the truth. That must be the truth of our being. We're living in a shared dream. We are living in what we call reality, and we discuss with one another as reality, when in fact it's not. It's not. It is a perception. It is an interpretation. It is kind of like a shared dream, like the movie The Matrix. It's like we're all together in this dream. And every once in a while, somebody awakens from it. Somebody somebody breaks loose from it and says, you know, everything that you've worried about, everything that you've struggled with, everything that you've ever been upset with, all of the things that people in the news are arguing with one another about, none of that's important. None of that's real. All of that's contrived. All of that's made up. Now, for the people who are engaged in that, it seems very real and it seems very important. But there's no struggle in the mind of God. God doesn't see it that way. So what we endeavor to do, what we're talking about doing today, is can we find the truth, the best that we can perceive it, because our understanding of truth is always going to be evolving. But can we find the truth, and can we see things as God would see them, as the divine within us would see them? And can we keep our mind stayed on that, focused on that? Last week we talked about focus. Can we pay attention to that? Can we pay attention to what we're thinking about? And if our thoughts are running astray, can we gently bring them back to the truth? So that's what we're talking about today, is life is a celebration. Life is meant to be a celebration. You know, when we do funeral services, they're called the celebration of life. You know, and everybody talks about this beautiful life that has passed before us and left this plane. And I'm thinking, let's not wait until we're dead. Let's not wait until we're gone and to decide that life's a celebration. Let's celebrate life every minute of every day. Let's celebrate the goodness of the divine every minute of every day. Let's look for the good. Let's cause ourselves to see the good that must be everywhere, because God is everywhere present. God is all presence. So what has happened to us, if we think about it, we go back to this to the Buddhist concept of conditioned mind and unconditioned mind. And there are things, and there are just the things the way that they are. And we are endeavoring and trying to see things as they are. But we must remember that as they are is a spiritual truth. We're trying to see things as they are, but what happens is we see things as we believe they are. We see something, and then all of a sudden memories and emotions, recollections, ideas come back to us. We start labeling and identifying. It's this, it's not that. It's good, it's bad. And we start to act as if that is the real truth of whatever it is that we are seeing. And it's not necessarily. But it is, as far as we are concerned. That is our experience. Now we understand that as we believe, as we think and believe in our hearts, so it is. So if our attitude towards life, if our point of view towards life, if our world view is one of strain, is one of struggle, is one of combat and fighting and willpower and dominance and control, and we have to have our way, we have to bend other people to our will. If that is our belief, that this is the way life should be lived, then that will be our experience. That will be our experience. You remember this story about the Quaker farmer who was sitting on his porch, and a car went by, and a man stopped, and he said, said to the farmer, "Can you tell me how to get to whatever the name of the next town was?" And the farmer said, well, it's just up the road. And the farmer, and the fellow driving the car says, well, what kind of people will I find there? And the farmer said, well, what kind of people did you have? Where are you coming from? And he says, oh, he says, you know, he says, they were terrible, they were mean, they were a bunch of cheats and a bunch of thieves, and that's why I'm leaving. I want to go someplace else. And the farmer said, well, I'm sorry to tell you this, but you'll probably find people just like that wherever you go. And a little while later, another car came along, and the fellow asked the same question. The farmer told him that town's right up the road. And he says, what kind of people will I find there? And the farmer said, well, what kind of people did you have at the last place? And he said, oh, they were wonderful people. They were kind. They were loving. And the farmer said, well, those are the kind of people you'll find up there. And somebody was sitting on the porch with the farmer and said to him, how can that be? You know, you told one fellow that the people he would find would be good, and you told the other people that the other fellow the people he would find would be bad. And he says, well, you know, that's the kind of people they expect. That's the kind of people they'll meet. See? So the experience that we have going through life, the experience that we have, is more dependent on our beliefs and our expectations and our worldview than it is on the way things really are. If we think that things are good, we're going to find it good. If we think that things are not, we're going to find them not to be so good. Years ago, when I was in customer service, I had a customer that every time he answered the phone, you'd say, how are you doing today? And he'd say, terrible, terrible, just terrible. And Chris, he was being overly dramatic because whatever issue he had that day, he wanted it to be a big crisis, so we would take care of it immediately. And I was just starting to get into this teaching and reading the things that that we read. And I just couldn't believe it, you know. I don't know how many times a day that man answered the phone, but every time he did, he was reinforcing that his life was terrible, his experiences were terrible, everything was terrible. And it costs no more, it takes no more energy for us to see the good. But we have to train ourselves to do that. The world in which we live is bent towards looking for danger, bent towards looking for trouble. Right? In times when we were kind of living in the wild, when survival was more difficult than it is today, you know, people who could foretell trouble, the soothsayers and those who gave guidance to the kings and things like that, they were very valuable. They were very valuable because they could warn people of pending doom. And if you warned people of pending doom, if the pending doom didn't come, that was okay. You know, if you didn't warn them of pending doom and something terrible happened, well, then they would get rid of that that counsel and they would bring somebody new in. So it was always best to kind of err on the side of danger. We've kind of grown up in that culture. Always looking for what is it in this situation that could cause me harm. It's kind of like learning to drive defensively. You know, it's you taught to drive, always expect something terrible is going to happen and how are you going to get away from it? And it can become self-defeating because if you're always expecting something terrible to happen, what do you think is going to happen? So we have to recognize two things then. We have to recognize that, first of all, it is our attitude towards life. It is done unto us according to our belief. It is our attitude towards life that actually determines our experience. If we have the knowledge of good or the knowledge of evil, we shall have the experience that goes with it. And the second thing then is that we, you and I, we can change whatever it is. We have to become mindful of what we're thinking. And we just simply have to bring ourselves back to the, but wait a minute, What is the truth of the situation here? What is the truth of this? I just read something, something beautiful a few minutes ago, and it was from a meditation, a Buddhist meditation, and it was about giving and receiving and being love and being loving. And the author was saying, can I sit and hold the hand of someone as they're dying and understand that they're suffering? And at the same time understand that there's a higher truth where suffering doesn't exist. Can we hold the pair of opposites in our consciousness? Can we see that things as they are not as they need to be? Can we see that there's a greater possibility? So one way to do it is, you know, Don McGill Rue says to be impeccable with your word, right? The four agreements. First one is be impeccable with your word. Be impeccable with your word. What am I saying? Do I listen to myself? What am I saying here? What are people around me saying? And am I silently agreeing with them? He tells us that which we do not disagree with, we have silently agreed with. So if you're working with somebody who says, oh, it's terrible, if you don't stop and say to yourself, no, it's not. That's your experience. That's not my experience. No, it's not. You have bought into it. So we want to be aware of what we are thinking, and we want to train ourselves to look for the good. We want to train ourselves to celebrate. So think of the magic of the experience. Think of how beautiful everything is, and take time to notice it. We take the sunrise for granted. We take the sun crossing the sky every day. We take that for granted. For those who live down at the beach, you know, the tide comes in twice a day, goes out twice a day. We forget. We forget the balance, and we forget the harmony, and we forget the beauty of life, you know. I think those in the olden days, I think people who spent more time outdoors than we do, they could appreciate the beauty because they were there and they saw it. There's a something that we call life, and it takes so many beautiful forms, and it is a compulsion. It is something that must express itself. Think of how diverse life on this planet is. If you think of human life, you know, human beings live at the equator and human beings live almost at the poles. Human beings live on a diet of nothing but vegetables, fruit, and things like that. And other human beings live on a diet of animal blubber. How diverse life is, how adaptable it is, how it finds a way to express itself in whatever conditions it finds itself in. Here on the surface of the earth, you know, we breathe in oxygen. It wasn't always that way, right? There was a shift in the earth's atmosphere. Oxygen was like poison to the forms of life that existed at that time. But now we have oxygen, and everything has learned to adapt to that. Everything has learned to use that for the purpose of expressing life. But if you watch the documentaries where they take, you know, the little submarines, and they go down to the deepest parts of the ocean, they go down to the volcanic vents down there, where the sulfur is pouring out of the vents. And there's life down there that has learned how to survive on the sulfur. And to those forms of life, oxygen is poison. We couldn't live down there. Those forms of life couldn't live up here. But life is expressing itself in a magnificent way, in a magnificent way. I grew up in an area surrounded by salt marsh, and I know many of the people who listen on Sunday are down at the coast, and the sea oats would come up through almost anything. You know, they're just like a little hollow tube of straw. And I don't know if you ever remember when we were kids, there was something we would do where you take a straw and you put your finger over the end of it, and you could punch it into a potato, and the straw would go straight into the potato, and you could pull it out, and it would have removed part of the potato. I don't remember why we did that, but we did. So this hollow straw can pass up through things. And they would go into a part of the marsh that had never been developed before, and they would start to put roads in through it. You know, and they would go in and they would put, as they do, they would go in and they would grade sand and they would grade gravel, and then they would come and they would put a thin layer of tar over the top of it, or asphalt over the top of it, and they'd put a road through there. And in a couple of years, the sea oats, the sprawl, would have pushed up straight through the asphalt, and the marsh was reclaiming the land. So it took a constant effort. It took a constant effort on the part of the people maintaining the roads. It took a constant effort on their part to push the life back down, because the life wanted to express itself. Can we see that? Can we see the magic in that? Can we see just how wonderful that is? Can we see past the struggle of human beings trying to put a road in a marsh, and the sea oats trying to take back their marsh? Can we see back through that and say, my gosh, isn't life wonderful? Life is expressing itself perfectly. In the morning, I'm down at the beach. The seabirds, at sunrise, the seabirds would start flying out. They have a nest. There's an island actually called Bird Island down in the Cape Fear River. And it was made of dredging materials. When the Corps of Engineers went through there and dredged out the channel, they pumped up the dirt and made this big island. And the birds took it over. It's called Bird Island. And in the morning, you can just stand there at the coast, and you can watch thousands and thousands and thousands of birds as they fly out to sea. And if you go back at sunset, you can watch them come back and go nest on Bird Island for the evening. What is it within them that guides them? What is it within them that knows? What is it within them that trusts? They just simply do what comes natural to them. The sun comes up, and they move out to sea, and the food that they need is already there. They spend their day at sea fishing, and in the evening they come back and they rest. They are such an integral part of the cycle of life that they, as far as we know, they don't do these things consciously. They just are. They just let it be. So what we want to do, what we aspire to do then, is to recognize that as we let go of the false ideas, as we let go of all of the things that tell us, but you know, we need to worry about that, but this needs to be a struggle, but we need to do this, but we need to do that. What we need to do is we need to see with the spiritual truth. We need to see as God sees. We need to catch God being God today. So it's like we have our little magnifying glass and our little Deerslayer cap that Sherlock Holmes wore. And we're going around looking for clues. And the clues that we are looking for is we are catching God being God today. In the midst of every situation, in the midst of holding someone's hand while they are dying. Life is good because we know the spiritual truth that life is never born and life never dies. We may have an experience of birth, we may have an experience of death as we pass through one, from one lifetime to another. But life was never born. Life can never die. What is the good? What is the good in our lives today? This is why breath meditation is such an important practice. I think we breathe somewhere between like 20 and 30,000 times a day. We're not even aware of it most of the time. We're not even aware of it. Can we take a few minutes to bring ourselves in tune with breath? Can we take a few minutes to be aware of just how good life is, just how good God is? Can we celebrate? Can we celebrate the activity that we call breathing? We don't even think about it. See, we spend most of our time thinking about things that are never going to come to pass anyway. What a miracle this is. The oxygen is there. The lungs are here. There is an intelligence that knows how to bring in the oxygen and give out the carbon dioxide. On the flip side of that are the trees. And the carbon dioxide is in the air. And there's an intelligence within them that knows how to breathe it in and give us back oxygen. And can you kind of get this, the infinity symbol is like a figure eight on its side. You've seen that. And our breath goes out and it goes into the trees and it turns and it comes back to us. And we breathe it in and we breathe it out and it goes back to the trees. And it's almost like this infinity symbol, the air moving back and forth. Can we take time? Can we take time to be aware of that? Can we see the beauty in the sunrise? Can we feel the power in the sunset? When we stop to eat a meal, can we recognize just how miraculous that is as well? How many lives have touched the food that we eat? Those who planted, those who harvested, those who processed, those who trucked, those who stocked the shelves, those who checked us out, those who prepared the food in our home. We take that for granted. And yet it's perfect harmony. How is it that our bodies know what to do with the food when we take it in? Frederick Bales or Dr. Holmes or both in their writings talk about this. You eat a sandwich and your body knows how to digest it. And some parts of it go and become bone, and some parts go and become muscle, and some parts go and become blood. And how did it know to do that? And if you and I had to sit here and we had to take apart that sandwich and we had to analyze it with our intellect and we had to say to ourselves, now you here, okay, bread, I want you to go become muscle. And we look at the cheese and we say, cheese, I want you to go and become bone. And we look at the meat and we say, meat, I want you to become blood. We wouldn't know how to do that. We couldn't do it. And yet there's an intelligence within that knows how to do it. If you were injured and you lost a pint of blood, would you be able to sit there and say, well, now in order to build that pint of blood back up in my body, I need to drink so many glasses of water, I need to have so many tablespoons of salt, I need to have this, I need to have that, I need to have the other. We don't know how to do that. But the love that has created us does. And it gives us appetite, and it makes us thirsty. And we start to crave certain foods. And gently and lovingly, it says, do this, do this, do this, eat that. And it repairs itself. So what I'm suggesting is that the way that we view the world, if we view the world as being a hostile place that is full of tension and full of struggle, and we have to survive, and we have to be at the top of our game, and we have to be vigilant, and all of these things that normally society tells us, if we believe those, then that is the experience that we will have. But if we stop and shake those off and recognize that life wasn't meant to be a struggle, it was meant to be a celebration, we can change our worldview, we can change what we wish to see. Instead of seeing the struggle in everything, we can see the good. The example of the sea oats coming up through the asphalt, you might see that as a struggle, a conflict of will, man against nature and all those things. But the sea oats never groaned. They never gave a sense of struggle. They just came up. They were reaching towards the sun in spite of the obstacles that were in their way. Persistence, like we talked last week, persistence and focus. Persistence. What is good about today? What is good about our lives today? Can we look for that? Can we take time to celebrate that? And at some point as we're doing this, I think we have to stop and marvel at how life itself is celebrating as us, through us, because we are its instruments of joy. We are its instruments of love. We can look at the sunrise and see more than a sunrise. We can watch the seabirds in flight and suddenly be connected to all of life. We can see the good and experience the good in all things, in us, as us, and through us. So I invite you this week, I invite you to take time in the morning when you get up and remind yourself that life is a celebration. And we're not going to wait for our funeral to recognize that. Life is joy. We are going to remind ourselves of that every minute, of every second, of every day. When things to the opposite come to our attention, and they will, at the water cooler, through the radio, through the TV, in the newspaper, we're going to remind ourselves that that is the experience. That is the experience of humanity. But that's not the experience we choose to have. Life has enough people to worry. There are people lining up to volunteer to worry. Life can use more people who are lining up to dance. The universe is having a celebration. The universe is having a party. And you are the location. You are the spot. You are the point where the divine expresses and experiences life as you, through you, in you. Let's let the divine have the best time, the most joy that it possibly can, as us and through us. And we let go of every idea of struggle. And so it is. Alrighty. So I'm all discombobulated this morning. I didn't bring my creative thought with me because I was trying to get the computer going. So we come together this morning in this closing treatment. And we release and we let go of every and any idea that believes in the need of struggle. We allow ourselves to be filled at this very moment with God's joy, with God's peace. The book of Genesis tells us that when God created, God looked upon his creation and declared it to be good. Who are we to call it not good? We dedicate our lives to recognizing the good that God saw in everything, the activity of perfect wisdom, the activity of perfect love, the activity of perfect joy, in, as, and through everyone, even those we may not like. We let the light of God's love shine deeply in our being. And it drives out everything unlike itself. We are grateful for this opportunity to be here today together. And we release this treatment to the perfect law, knowing so certainly it is done, that we say together, and so it is.